Welcome to Chapter 2 in the Exoplanet Detection series here in the Cool Worlds classroom. In Chapter 1, we established some foundational resource in celestial mechanics, and that meant a lot of mathematics, a lot of hard work. But now we get to reap the rewards of all of that effort. In today's video, we will be using those early results to derive the equation governing the radial velocity method of detecting exoplanets. Radial velocity detections dominated planet catalogues for the first decade and a half of the exoplanet era, and are often still considered the gold standard of planet detection. For these reasons, then, it is crucial for every exoplaneteer to understand how this method works. There's a lot to be said about the radial velocity method, far more than I am able to cover in a single short video. Now, as discussed in the trailer for this channel, the videos that we have posted so far are really just a sample set, and we're hoping to find funding to support the content here going forward into the future. And in that vein, this video today will actually be the last video of this sample series. So if you haven't already, then please do offer us some feedback so that we can make these videos even better going forward into the future. Back to the topic at hand, you might be wondering who is pictured here at the bottom. This is Otto Struve, an astronomer often credited as the first person to consider the possibility of detecting exoplanets with the radial velocity method all the way back in 1952. His short essay didn't get noticed much until recent years, but I think it's a remarkable historical example of scientific foresight. Now, the basic idea of the radial velocity method is likely something that you've encountered before, but it's very simply the act of measuring the red or blue shift of a star's light, or more precisely, a star's spectrum. These red and blue shifts tell us how fast the star is moving relative to the Earth, its velocity. After correcting for the Earth's orbital motion, any changes in a star's velocity means an acceleration, dv dt. And we know from F equals ma that whenever there's an acceleration, that means there must be a force responsible. Now, when it comes to moving a star, really the only force that's possible here is gravity. And so immediately, just seeing a change in the radial velocity tells us that there must be a gravitational body, such as a planet, nearby, tugging on that star. Here we see a snapshot of a star moving towards us in response to its planet. This is often dubbed reflex motion. In this snapshot, the star is moving towards us, and so it would appear blue shifted. Now recall from video 1D that we define the observer to lie along the Z axis. Since radial velocity exclusively refers to motion along the line of sight, then that means that we are measuring dz dt. Okay, now also from video 1D, we obtained these Cartesian orbital elements. The top here is the heliocentric planet positions, and the bottom show the planet and stellar motion in the barycentric frame of reference. So that Z star term over here is the one that we really care about. Specifically, radial velocity is conventionally defined as minus dz dt plus a constant gamma, which is just the speed at which the star is essentially drifting through the galaxy. The choice of that minus sign is just by convention. It's totally arbitrary, but it means that things moving away from us, which are red-shifted, have a positive radial velocity. Let's save these two equations and move them over to a new slide. That R term in the Z star equation represents the planet-star separation, and is something that we determined back in video 1C, so let's just plug that in. That yields the following, which can be tidied up a little through rearrangement to this. Now, let's go back to the RV equation and expand it using the chain rule. This helps us because we can't directly differentiate z with respect to time, but we can do so with respect to true anomaly f. The df dt term is again something that we derived earlier in video 1e, so we can now just use that result here too. After differentiating, you should be able to show this result for the RV signal, where k is a time-invariable quantity known as the semi-amplitude, given by this. Now, I want you to pause the video here and try deriving this for yourself to do that differentiation and rearrangement step. Make sure that you get the same result. Alright, good job. Now let's see what these RV signals really look like. Here's a pretty famous example. It's our nearest star, Proxima Centauri, which has an Earth-mass planet around it. Here we have a nice circular orbit giving us a sinusoidal signal, but we'll later show how eccentric planets can look quite different. So the semi-amplitude K can really just be read off this plot. So too can the orbital period P, given by the time it takes for the signal to repeat itself. The RV function is this red line, which has actually been fitted to the data given by the teal points. So already we can see there's a lot of information about the planet encoded within this dataset. If we look at this equation for K, we see both A, the semi-major axis, and P, the orbital period, featuring. But via Kepler's third law, that is generally redundant. So let's replace A with P, since P is the only observable between those two. Why? Well, remember that I can read P off that plot back there, but I can't read A off that graph. There's just nothing directly telling me what the semi-major axis is. After replacing with Kepler's third law, this gives us the following more conventional way of writing the semi-amplitude equation. Another way of writing this is in so-called canonical units, where we plug in numbers for a fiducial example, in this case a Jupiter, on a one-year period around a sun-like star, and then we rewrite the parameters as scalings. This is instructive because it gives us a sense as to how big this signal is and the relevant proportionalities. Note that I have also assumed here that mass of the star is much greater than mass of the planet, just to simplify things a little bit. So let's look at these scalings closely. The RV semi-amplitude, K, decreases with P, but not very steeply, just with a one-third power. So what that means, for example, is that a planet with an 8 times longer orbital period would only reduce the semi-amplitude by a factor of 2. Turning to M star, we see an almost inverse relationship, which means that lighter stars give bigger signals. Okay, that makes sense because lighter stars are easier to wobble. And finally, we find a linear scaling with respect to planet mass. That means that heavier planets wobble the star more and are thus easier to find. Critically, notice that there's a pesky sin I term in here. That sin I term is crucial, because in general, we don't know what its value is. So in truth, we don't really measure MP, only MP multiplied by sin I. Now since sin I is a number which is always less than 1, then that means that MP sin I is often referred to as the minimum mass. This is a really important and basic limitation of the radial velocity method. Truthfully, radial velocities don't measure planet masses, they only measure minimum planet masses. If we go back to the full equation, without assuming M star is much greater than MP, I want to highlight another important point. These terms here are easily known. There's G and pi, which are just constants, and P, which comes from the periodicity of the RV signal itself. Likewise, eccentricity can be measured from the shape of the RV waveform. But this stuff here in the middle, this is a priori unknown and directly controls the semi-amplitude. It's a bit of a mathematical jumble and is often just simply coined the mass function. Or to really follow historical convention, it should be called the cube of the mass function. Now the problem with this mass function is that MP, the mass of the planet, appears in 2 places. It's non-trivial to rearrange this equation and get MP equals something. In other words, it's tricky to figure out what a planet's mass is for any given RV signal. Now, there are strategies to do this. First, as we did so earlier, we can just assume that the star is much heavier than the planet, essentially ignoring the MP term in the denominator. That makes the math far simpler, we can now directly solve, and that's actually the most common practice, but it is of course an approximation and thus not entirely correct. The second and more challenging approach is to solve the cubic equation in MP, which can actually be done analytically, although it's rather ugly. How different are these two results? Well, for the heaviest of planets, or even brown dwarfs, the tension between these two could perhaps become significant, but actually, I don't know how significant. So why not investigate this for yourself? As a mini research project, try calculating the mass of the planet from K, P, and E as listed in the exoplanets.org catalog using these two methods for a bunch of planets and see whether they disagree more than the formal errors. As I said, I don't know the answer to this. This is genuinely a novel research idea, so please go ahead, take it, and have some fun. So that wraps us up for today, and indeed for this sample set of videos. Now, obviously there's a lot more I could and would like to say about radial velocity, so hopefully we'll get funding to be able to extend this series in the future. And if we do, we'll be able to talk about not just other exoplanet detection methods aside from radial velocities, but even an entire new series besides from the exoplanet detection series as well. So if you have any feedback about the videos we've produced so far, I mean, this is a sample set, this is the time to give us some direct feedback. Let us know what you think and how we could maybe improve it going forward. Thank you so much for your time and watching these. If you are missing us in the meantime before we come back, then do make sure you check out our main channel over at the Cool Worlds Lab. Until then, bye for now.